So having seen the basic notions of lattices, let's briefly talk about how we construct lattices. So there are these constructions called power set construction with subset or superset relation, and then there are products of lattices, and then there are set of mappings as lattices. Now let us look at lattices that are power sets. Let's consider the underlying set S. This could be a set of expressions, this could be a set of definitions, this could be a set of variables. Regardless of what elements does this set contain, we can still construct a power set lattice by showing power set of S as 2 raised to S. That's the notation that we use. And this power set itself is a set, and we define a partial order with this set. There are two partial orders. One of the two partial orders that we choose, the first partial order that we choose is a superset relation. So the set 2 raised to S with partial order superset relation is a lattice. Note that the superset relation is a valid partial order because it is reflexive, transitive, and antisymmetric. So such a lattice, a power set with superset relation, is a lattice in which the top element is the empty set. That makes sense because every subset of S, which is every element in 2 raised to S, is a superset of empty set. Similarly, the bottom element of 2 raised to S, the lattice with 2 raised to S under superset relation, is the bottom element is the universal set S. This is so because S is a superset of every element in 2 raised to S. For this lattice, we define the partial order. X is weaker than Y if X is a superset of Y. X meet Y, the GLB of Y is computed by taking the union of X and Y. Similarly, X join Y is computed by taking intersection of X and Y. We have used such a lattice in live variables analysis, reaching definitions analysis, and partially available expressions analysis. Note that we didn't need the join operation. We only used the meet operation, which was union. On the other hand, if we take the set 2 raised to S and change the partial order, if instead of a superset relation, if we choose a subset relation as a partial order, then that's also a lattice, except that in this case, now the top element is the set S, which is fine because every element in 2 raised to S is a subset of S. Similarly, the bottom element of this lattice is empty set, which is fine because empty set is a subset of every element in 2 raised to S. Now we say for this lattice, X is weaker than Y if and only if X is a subset of Y. And now in order to compute the meet of X and Y, the GLB of X and Y, we intersect X and Y. In order to compute join of Y, we take a union of X and Y. We use such a lattice in available expressions analysis and anticipable expressions analysis. Note again that we needed only the meet operation, which is the intersection, and we did not use the join operation, which is union, for these frameworks, available expressions analysis and anticipable expressions analysis. The other way of constructing a lattice is taking a Cartesian product of two lattices. So here we have shown these two lattices. There is a lattice on numbers, this N stands for numbers, and there is a lattice on alphabet, A stands for alphabet. So we have 1, 2 is weaker than 1, 3 is also weaker than 1, and 4 is weaker than 2 and 3. There is no particular interpretation that we wish to attach to this particular partial order, except that we say that this is a lattice LN with the partial order shown by this Hasse diagram and with the associated join operation associated meet operation and the associated join operation. Similarly, on the alphabet lattice, we have partial order, the meet operation, and the join operation. For convenience, we have attached N as a subscript to lattice on numbers and A as a subscript for the operations on the lattice of alphabet. When we take a Cartesian product, what do we mean by a Cartesian product? Now, this lattice, these two lattices are essentially sets. The first lattice is a set 1, 2, 3, 4, and the second lattice is a set A, B. So when we take a Cartesian product, essentially we have to create pairs of every element in N with every element in A. So we create, first we create, we take pairs of 1, 2, 3, 4 with A, and we create this structure 1, A, 2, A, 3, A, and 4, A. Here the element A is common in the tuple, so therefore the partial order is induced by the relation between 1, 2 and 1, 3 and 3, 4 and 2, 2 and 4. So that's the relationship, the partial order between these pairs. Now similarly, we take pairs of 1, 2, 3, 4 with B and we get 1, B, 2, B, 3, B, 4, B. Again, because B element is same between all these pairs, the partial order between these two pairs is decided by the weaker than relation between 1 and 2. Similarly, this partial order is decided by the weaker than relation between 2 and 4. This partial order, this relation, this placement is decided by the partial order between 3 and 4. And this relation, this edge, is decided by the partial order between 1 and 3. Now we need to define partial order between these elements and these elements. And that's easy to see because when we take 1, A and 1, B, 1 and 1 is same, but B is weaker than 1. So we have 1, B weaker than 1, A. Similarly, 2, B is weaker than 2, A. Similarly, 3, B is weaker than 3, A. And 4, B is weaker than 4, A. And we draw these edges to show the weaker than relation. And then we fold these two into each other. And then we get this lattice. And we use the letter C to say this is a composite lattice or a Cartesian product lattice, which with the set LC, the partial order denoted with C, this join operation denoted with subscript C, this meet operation denoted with subscript C, and this join operation denoted with subscript C. Taking this product allows us to define this relation and these operations on the composite lattice in the following way. On the composite lattice, x1, y1 is weaker than x2, y2 if in the number lattice, x1 is weaker than x2 and y1 is weaker than y2, where the weaker than relation is with respect to M for the first elements, first elements in the pairs, and the weaker than relation with respect to A for the second elements in the pairs. Similarly, the meet operation on these two is defined as pointwise meet of these two elements. So meet of these two pairs, x1, y1 meets x2, y2 is defined as x1 meet x2, and this meet comes from the number lattice, which is because x1 and x2 are the elements that belong to the number lattice. Similarly, the second element is a meet of y1 and y2, and y1 and y2 belong to the alphabet lattice, so their values are merged with the meet operation over alphabet lattice. In a similar manner, we have x1, y1 join x2, y2, which is defined as x1, x2 joined in the number lattice, and y1, y2 joined in the alphabet lattice. So this is how, from given two lattices, we can construct a Cartesian product of the lattices. Cartesian product is one form of a product lattice. There is another form of product lattice which we want to look at now. So we had this Cartesian product defined like this in the previous slide. Now we define, so we have x1, x2 coming from L1 and y1, y2 coming from L2, and their product lattice is a lattice of pairs x1, y1, x2, y2. And in case of Cartesian product, we saw that the pair x1, y1 is weaker than the pair x2, y2 if x1 is weaker than x2 in the lattice, in the first lattice, and y1 is weaker than y2 in the second lattice. Recall that x's are coming from the first lattice and y's are coming from the second lattice. So this is how we define the Cartesian product. Now we define something called interval product, which is similar to the Cartesian product, except that there is a subtle difference, and the difference is we say x1 y1 is weaker than x2 y2 if x1 is weaker than x2 in the first lattice, but y1 is stronger than y2 in the second lattice. The difference between interval product and Cartesian product is that here we have stronger than, in the Cartesian product we have weaker than. In the Cartesian product, every element is pointwise weaker than. In the interval product, the first element is weaker than and the second element is stronger than, because interval gives us a lower limit and a higher limit. So interval tells us lower limit and upper limit and lower limit. So upper limit is chosen to be higher and the lower limit is chosen to be smaller. So therefore, x1, y1 merged with, meet with x2, y2 is defined as taking the meet of x1, x2 in the first lattice, but taking the join of y1, y2 in the second lattice. Similarly, the join is the dual, where we take the join of the first element, the lower limit, and the meet of the upper limit. So examples are integer lattices with weaker than relation as less than equal to and stronger than relation as greater than equal to. So we have 2, 10 is an interval here. We are assuming that both the elements are included. In some literature, round braces show that these boundaries are, the limits are excluded, and for inclusion people use square parenthesis, but we are not going to make that distinction. For us, both 2 and 10 are included in the interval, which means that this pair 2, 10 is a set of integers 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7, 8, 9, 10, both 2 and 10 inclusive. So if we have this pair 2, 10 and 5, 50, then the meet of them computes 2, 50, which means that the meet computes the smallest interval containing both the intervals. Note that the interval 2, 50 contains 2, 10 fully, as well as 5, 50 fully. So we have taken the lower limit of the first interval and the upper limit of the second interval. So the meet of these two will give us 2, 5, the lower element is 2, and the larger between 10, 50 gives us 50. So that's the meet element of these two intervals. Similarly, the join of these two intervals is 5, 10. So the join computes the largest interval contained in both the intervals. So 5, 10 is the interval that's contained in both 2, 10 and 5, 50, and is the largest such interval. The final variant of the lattices that we want to see is the set of mappings. Given a set A and a lattice L1, the set of mappings L is a set of mappings from A to L, and it is also a lattice. Here A is not a lattice. We do not require A to be a lattice, but A could well be a lattice. So let's consider the X and Y, capital X and capital Y, as elements in L, and small a in capital A, the set A, and small XY in L1. Then we say that X, capital X, is weaker than capital Y if for all A in this should be capital A and not S, I will change this in the slides. For all A in capital A, A comma X is in X and A comma Y is in Y and X is weaker than Y. Meaning we are comparing the values associated with specific element. We are not going to compare A comma X with B comma X or B comma Y. We are going to compare A comma X with A comma Y, A comma Z, B comma X with B comma Y, B comma Z, etc. Similarly, when we take a meet of these two, we say that if we have, once again, this should be capital A and not S. So if we have A comma X in A X and A comma Y in Y, then for I, we for the element A in capital A, we take a meet of X comma Y. Similarly, join is defined as the join of the values corresponding to the element A. The example of this lattice is in constant propagation, and we will study this formally later. But assuming that we have three variables P, Q and R, some examples of X and Y are P maps to 3, Q maps to empty set, R maps to 5, or P maps to non-constant or the universal set Z, this should read as Z, and Q maps to 15 and R also maps to Z. These are examples of mappings. Note that A comma X in the product lattice X is same as A maps to X in X when X is a function. Meaning for every element in A, we have exactly one value in L, assuming that it is a total function. So this completes our study of lattice theory, and we will look at the other details of lattice theory and applications of lattice theory when we look at the data flow values. Now we will, in the next part of the lecture, will contextualize all things that we have learned about lattices to data flow analysis.